Moldova, Ukraine, and Georgia all have association agreements with the EU. Strong movements within the countries are pushing for further rapprochement with Europe. Are they on the road to membership? Moldova, Ukraine, and Georgia, alongside Belarus, Armenia, and Azerbaijan, are all part of the Eastern Partnership, an extension of Europe's neighborhood policy, which is an initiative to ensure stability in countries in close geographic proximity to the European Union. Europe's neighborhood policy dates back to 2004, after the largest round of EU expansion, and it has sought to set the EU's borders and slow down further enlargement. Instead of adding more countries to the EU, it aimed to create regions of economic and regulatory alignment, in effect integrating countries with the EU, but without granting them membership. In the words of Romano Prodi, president of the European Commission between 1999 and 2004, this meant sharing everything but institutions with those countries. The Eastern Partnership started in 2009 as a way to deepen and strengthen relations with the EU's eastern neighbors. In other words, it is meant to influence and align the neighborhood to European values, and as a result, it focuses on many of the same aspects as those for EU accession. It aims to foster a strong economy through economic development and market opportunities, stronger governance by strengthening institutions and promoting good governance, stronger connectivity by improving energy efficiency, environment and climate change policy, and stronger society by improving mobility and people-to-people contacts. And in a similar way to the cohesion and stability funds that the EU gives to Eastern European EU members and the Balkan candidate countries, the EU has given out 600 million euros to the countries of the Eastern Partnership over the past decade. It has loaned money to local companies, invested in civil society, and built energy and transport infrastructure. By building stronger economies supported by the rule of law in its neighborhood, the EU can reap the rewards from trade. Giuseppe Borrell, the EU Foreign Affairs Chief, has said at a recent EU-Ukraine summit that
we are not an ONG. We are not acting by just a charity. We are acting because it is in our own interest to help Ukraine to develop and to be a free, prosperous, and secure country.
To a large extent, the trade component has worked. Between 2006 and 2018, trade between the EU has increased by 15% with Armenia, 17% with Azerbaijan, 19% with Belarus, 6% with Georgia, 20% with the Republic of Moldova, and 24% with Ukraine. But the countries of the partnership do not all have the same ambitions for it. Ukraine, Moldova, and Georgia have burgeoning democratic and pro-EU movements, while Belarus, Armenia, and Azerbaijan remain closely aligned with Russia. This is clearly visible when protests erupt in those countries. Ukrainian, Georgian, and Moldovan protests see EU flags make regular appearances as part of their democratic aspirations to join the EU. One of the main challenges facing the Eastern Partnership countries wishing to join the EU is Russian opposition. All the countries of the Eastern Partnership are former parts of the Soviet Union, and Russia continues to play a significant role in the region, mostly through frozen conflicts to prevent them from falling into the European Union's sphere of influence. Russia has also funded and advised politicians to keep its influence there, supporting the political parties and politicians that align with its interests, and acting as kingmaker. Yet there are signs that the country is losing its grip. Revolutions in the 2000s in Ukraine and Georgia saw pro-Russian politicians removed from office and replaced with pro-Western reformists. As Russian influence campaigns have failed, it has not shied from intervening militarily in those countries. In 2008, it invaded Georgia to remove the newly elected Mikhail Saakashvili from power, eventually settling on taking North Ossetia and Abkhazia after international outrage stopped its invasion short. In a similar move in 2014, Russia invaded Crimea and initiated a proxy war in the Donbass in Ukraine, which had the purpose of destabilizing the country so that it could not align with the West, join the European Union, or NATO. Russia also has a peacekeeping force in Transnistria, an unrecognized breakaway part of Moldova, inhabited mostly by ethnic Russians and Ukrainians, which had been invited in 1992 by a Moldovan president, but has more recently refused calls by the Moldovan government to remove them. Those countries serve as a buffer between Russia and the West, and particularly the EU and NATO's enlargement, and Russia has sought to avoid their further alignment with the West. Yet the subversive actions that Russia has undertaken in these countries have backfired and only strengthened pro-EU and pro-Western movements, with 84% of Georgians, 68.1% of Ukrainians, and 56.2% of Moldovans in favor of joining the EU. Regardless of the situation with Russia, the countries are moving closer to Europe. All three of them have signed association agreements to align economic standards as well as pursue political cooperation with the EU. The EU is the largest trading partner of Ukraine, Moldova, and Georgia, accounting for 40, 64, and 23% of their trade respectively. This rapprochement is something that they are keen to pursue further, with the ultimate ambition being to join the European Union. Salome Zurabishvili, the Georgian president, has said that we intend to knock on every door, to open every door, and by the time we are finishing opening all the doors, you will discover that Georgia has become an EU member. And Ukrainian Prime Minister Denis Shmyhal has said, "I have no doubt that Ukraine will become a member of the European Union. However, it is no less important how we, the state and society, will advance along this way, move towards European standards. We are abandoning the Soviet-era vestiges in the mind and the economy. We are becoming more open and tolerant. We learn to care and to support each other. Our political culture is changing, society is changing." Yet, like the current candidate countries in the Western Balkans, which we covered in a previous video, their hopes may be dashed by the political and geopolitical reality of Europe. While the European Parliament has Georgia, Ukraine, and Moldova on the list of eligible countries to join the EU, many in Europe don't want to hear about further accession, and instead want to focus on the partnerships that they have signed. In the past, association agreements had served as a way to get a foot in the door before accession. The countries that were part of the Eastern Enlargement in 2004 and the Balkan Enlargements in 2007 and 2013 all had association agreements signed before they became members. But that is no longer true. The Dutch voted against an EU association agreement with Ukraine in a 2016 referendum out of fear that it would aid a corrupt country and lead to a path to membership. As a result of this referendum, the EU signed a political declaration before the association agreement with Ukraine, agreeing that there would be no establishment of EU candidate status for Ukraine through the association agreement. This is despite being in a comparable state to the current EU candidate and potential candidate countries, and even the latest additions to the EU. From an economic perspective, their GDPs are significantly lower than the European average, and from a political one, those countries rank poorly in corruption metrics, according to the World Bank and Transparency.org. But these metrics leave out one significant difference. The Western Balkans is seen as the next frontier of European enlargement, and a continuation of the process that has seen ex-Yugoslav countries admitted to the EU. They were promised accession, while the former Soviet republics of Georgia, Ukraine, and Moldova were not. This is part of the larger trend of enlargement fatigue, where the EU has invested significant political and financial resources to get the latest additions to catch up with EU standards, not always to great success. At the same time, offering candidate status to those countries would be geopolitical dynamite, not only within the EU, but with Russia, which has intervened when it judged that its former satellite countries were cozying up too much to the EU or to the West. This gap has been acknowledged by Georgian President Salome Zurabishvili, who has said that, "We understand the difficulties of the political decision to award a country the candidate status. One idea outside the box is for Georgia to start accession negotiations on an ad hoc basis. Such a pragmatic, non-institutional, non-political decision would be very significant and very important." Yet even this approach is no guarantee of joining, with the countries joining the EU's neighborhood policy and sphere of influence, but not the club as a whole. As Romano Prodi said, the relationship will be one of sharing everything but institutions. The country of the three most likely of joining is Moldova, though not as an independent country. Moldova, which was incorporated into the Soviet Union after World War II, could pursue reunification with Romania, and that is one of the political ambitions of Moldova's president. But even that outcome is uncertain. Like the ambitions of joining the EU, reunification with Romania would pose the same challenges: Russian opposition and political and economic backwardness. To conclude, the current status quo of economic integration with Europe will continue to take place at a snail's pace, with all parties aware of the geopolitical obstacles to accession, particularly with Russia, which has troops on the ground, and the willingness to intervene to conserve its sphere of influence. Internal EU objections to enlargement to countries closer to the geographic heart of Europe mean that countries on the European fringe are at the back of the line in terms of membership. On paper, the European Union is open to those countries joining, but the practical details are more complicated, and unlike the Western Balkans, for which the question is when they will join, Moldova, Ukraine, and Georgia face a question of if they can join. What Ukrainians, Moldovans, and Georgians see as the road to EU accession may in fact be the end of the road. This was InterEurope. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, make sure you like, comment, and subscribe to receive the latest updates and analysis on European news. Salome Zurabishvili, Denis Shmyhal, Shmihel, Dennis Shmihau,